Welcome once again students to the class of pricing and product decisions. This is once again your faculty Dr. Shweta Srivastava, associate professor, School of Management, BBDO University. So students, I hope you are getting the concepts of cost volume profit analysis, which we have been continuously studying with the help of various decision making situations. So till now we have studied the basic concepts related to break even point, CVP analysis, the graphical representation. We have come across with the situations like a single limiting factor, make or buy, shutdown or discontinue, or some other decision making situation, accept or reject proposal. So I think in all the cases we are considering the incremental cost, incremental contribution to sale, and incremental benefit, right? So students, I'll be taking up one more decision making situation in this lecture, and then we'll be discussing the sensitivity analysis related to this break-even point analysis, and lastly we'll be winding up this topic of break-even point with the this multi-product break-even point calculation, right students? So let's move ahead now. Further processing. Now, first of all, I'll be explaining you what is meant by further processing. See students, this topic I'll be taking up once again in your third unit, while I'll be taking up joint cost at length, right? So students, please remember this phenomena, and I'll be explaining you once again all the features in the third unit also. Now, what is the meaning of further processing? A joint production processes results in two or more products called joint products, right? See, I think all of you use petroleum products in the name of Vaseline, right? Or petroleum jelly, right? See, petroleum jelly is actually produced from crude oil, right? So crude oil passes with a proper processing, and after that some products, first of all you will get CNG, then LPG, then diesel, then petrol, and lastly the residue will be petroleum jelly. So students, all these products are coming out from one raw material, that is your crude oil, right? So you can say individual product generation, all this crude oil will pass from a joint production process, right? So these products are called as joint products till the split off point from where the product needs to be further processed, right? So a joint production process results in two or more products called joint products, like petroleum jelly, CNG, petrol, and all. The point in the production process where the joint products are identifiable as separate products is called the split off point, right? After split off point, the products will now be treated as individual products. Prior to that, they will be treated as a joint product, right? The joint cost of the processes are irrelevant as they represent sunk cost. See, while discussing with you the relevancy of cost concepts, I explained you what are sunk cost. Sunk cost are generally historical cost which are already incurred. So till the process or till the point of split off, what was happened, the joint cost were already incurred. So there is no point in calculate taking into consideration this joint cost. See students, I have been continuously telling you, you have to understand the concept of relevancy of cost and revenue, because we have to understand, see, what is the relevancy of cost? The relevancy of cost says that we have to take into consideration only those costs which are impacted by a particular decision, right? So whether we further that separate product or not, that is not relevant if we consider it. It means it does not require any sort of joint cost because it is already been incurred. So right, so joint costs are irrelevant as they represent sunk cost or they are already been incurred, right? We should consider the incremental cost and incremental revenue if we further process. Now here lies your decision making situation. You have to consider what cost, incremental cost and incremental revenue will be generated if we further process this identifiable separate product. So in the further decision making situation, we have to consider these two things: sell the products at the split off point, whether we sell the products at split off point while considering the incremental cost and revenue, or further process to produce products with enhanced value, right? So we should sell with the same quality at a split off point, or we should enhance the product value after further processing, right? This is what we have to understand. See, you have to confront two types of situations. One, to sell the product as it is at the split off point, or to increase the value of the product by further processing. This is what we have to analyze. Now again, I am taking up one example. Now R Limited produces two products from a single process during one period in which the process costs are expected to be £1,50,000, right? So the following outputs are expected. Product X gives you an output of 5,000 liters, product Y 15,000 liters. Selling price would be £15 per liter, and selling price for product Y would be £10 per liter. Each product can be further processed using skilled labor costing £10 per hour to create superior products Super X and Super Y. See, after getting product X and product Y at a split off point, we have an option to create superior products in the name of Super X and Super Y. Now, what will be the decision making situation? Either to sell the product as product Z, or to enhance its value by producing Super X, right? This is what we call decision making situation, right? So the following cost and revenue is, you can say this, the revenue and cost structure is as under. Now if you want to produce a product X to super product X, will further need 75 labor hours per liter, and the selling price would be £25, right? Here the selling price was £15. Here we are getting the incremental value of £10. The same goes with product Super Y. This will need 40 labor hour per liter, and the price will, the incremental price will be £3, because here we have £10 per liter and here we have £13 per liter. Now we have to advise the company what decision should company take: for process it further to Super X or Super Y, or sell as it is as product X and product Y. Now again, we are considering the incremental cost and incremental benefit. Incremental revenue, as I told you, we are selling 5,000 units. See here, it is written 5,000 liters. So 5,000 multiplied by incremental, that is £25 minus £15, that will give you £50,000. The same thing will go with £13 minus £10. £3 will be your incremental revenue multiplied by 15,000 liters, that will give you for Super Y. So incremental revenue for Super X will be £50,000, for Super Y it will be £45,000. Now we have to understand incremental cost. See, 0.75 hour multiplied by 75 hours multiplied by 5,000 units multiplied by £10. See, it is written here for product Y, the labor hours are written here. Yeah, this, the costing per 10 labor hour, right? This is the costing of labor hour. So that is why we have 75 hours are needed by Super X with the rate of £10, and how many liters we are producing? 5,000 liters. So that will give you a resultant figure of £37,500. The same we are doing it for 40 hours multiplied by 15,000. I think it's 0.75, students. This is per, yeah, exactly. This is 75 hours per liter, right? So this is 0.75 hour, 0.40 hours. So multiplied by 5,000 into £10, and 0.40 hour, since it is per liter. So 0.40 hour multiplied by 15,000 multiplied by £10. So it will give you a resultant figure of £60,000. So students, this is the incremental cost if we are moving from X to Super X, and this is the incremental cost when we are moving from Y to Super Y, right? So this will be your incremental benefit from Super X, and incremental cost benefit from, or you can say loss from Super Y. So in case of Super X, we are seeing that there is an incremental benefit of 0.12,500. But in case of Super Y, what you are seeing, that is an increment, this is incremental loss of £15,000, right? So see, you can find out easily that it is advisable to further process X and move to Super X, but it is not advisable to further process Super to Y to Super Y, because it is giving you a loss of incremental loss of £15,000, right? So this is what is written here: further process product X but sell product Y now, right? So students, this is these are the various decision making situations which are dealt by the concept of CVP analysis, right? So students, now let us understand sensitivity analysis. Now what do you mean by a person being sensitive? Sensitive means the person is prone to environmental changes, right? So a person is sensitive is termed as sensitive when he or she will readily react to environmental changes, right? So that person will be treated as sensitive, right? So in a case, what we are doing, we are actually considering the environmental changes or what is going to happen in the future. So when we conduct such type of analysis, how far that person is sensitive to environmental changes, that is known as sensitivity analysis. Now, see, we have to consider the impact of risk and uncertainty. How it is done, let us understand. To determine the effect of changes in variables such as fixed cost, variable cost and sale price on future profits. See students, you have to understand every time that we are making predictions, we are making forecasts. So these forecasts are generally made for future, and future is uncertain. So these decisions are based on forecast and which cannot be predicted with certainty. So when you are taking into consideration risk and uncertainty, it means you have a confidence level. It means how much confident you are that the forecasted are predicted accurately. So now when it comes to confidence level, we have to take into consideration the probability, right? So in this topic, we'll be discussing how we can utilize the concept of normal distribution to tackle the impact of risk and uncertainty. Now this is the question. A sales manager has identified fixed cost for a new product as £12 lakhs, right? The product is to be sold for £6 and has associated variable cost as £3.50. She predicts that the mean sales for the coming year would be 5,000 units. She also believes that the sales volume is normally distributed with a standard deviation of 16,000 units. What is the probability of at least breaking even, right? See students, we have to first of all find out what is the break even point and how far this assumption of break even unit is true. Means how much confidence, what is the probability of that this break even point will occur or do not occur, right? This is what we have to find out. Now, the break-even point will be calculated in the same way. We have 12 lakhs divided by S minus V, that is £6 minus £3.5, that will give you 4,80,000 units, right? But see, in the question, it is written that the mean sales would be 5,000 units. So if we consider the normal distribution, this mean line will be 5 lakhs, right? But what we have calculated, see this mean line, this is a normal distribution curve, it is as given in the question. So this mean line will indicate as 5 lakh units. Now the break even point which we have calculated is less by 20,000 units. So it will come to the left side of this 5 lakh mean sales, right? So now we'll draw another line with units 4,80,000, right? So now we have to calculate the Z value, because Z value will give you the probability of occurrence of this break even point as 4,80,000 units, right? So again, we'll be taking up the same formula of Z X minus mu divided by standard deviation. Mu will be your mean x will be your data point, right? See, basically what is z value? Z value is the shaded area, right? So z value will give you how many is how far you are from the group of data with the mean of with the mean mu, right? So we are seeing that we are this much far from this mean data, but this has to be converted into a z value. How will we convert it into a z value? X minus mu by divided by standard deviation. See, basically z value will give you that how much you are deviated, how far you have moved from the mean value, that is mu, right? So we'll get the figure 480,000 minus 5 lakh divided by 16,000, and you'll get the result as minus 1.25. See, why you are getting the figure minus 1.25? Because the break-even point is lesser than the mean value, right? But see, students, you have to know, you should understand one thing, that this mean line will divide symmetrically. This is since this is a normal distribution, this mean line will symmetrically divide the whole normal distribution curve into two equal halves, right? So whether you have 1.25 or minus 1.25, that will not affect the value of z, right? Now let us understand the question once again, then I'll explain you this line. It is written here, she also believes that the sales volume is normally distributed. Now, here the question is, what is the probability of at least breaking even, right? It is given here, at least break even. It means you can break even at 480,000 at least, or you can have the sales beyond this 480,000 also. So we have to take into consideration, while calculating the total area, what we have to take into consideration, this area also and this shaded area also, because at least you have to produce break even, right? Break even quantity. So that is why this area has a distance of 0.25, right? So this is what is written here from the table. I'll be explaining you the table in the next slide. Now, this is the Z table, students, right? This is your Z table. So what we have to calculate? We have to calculate the value of minus 1.25. This is your Z table. So students, it is easily available on internet, but for your perusal, I am explaining it here also. So how to look at 1.25? Now, see, 1.2 will be taking up from here, and see 0.05 from here. So you will be getting the value as 0.3944. I hope students it's clear. 1.2 I am taking from Z, and here I am taking 0.05. So see, this Z table is easily available on internet. And students, there is a one app also, Z calculator, which is from which you can only require to post the probability, and you will get the Z result, right? So here it is written as 0.3944. So now let us move to the question once again. See 0.1 minus 1.25 will give you a z value of 0.3944, as I explained in the next slides. Since the area above the mean has a probability of 0.5, right? This is the area 0.5. This area is 0.3944. So in total, what do we have? 0.5 plus 0.3944, giving a resultant of 0.8944. So to find out the probability, we have to multiply it by 100. So this is 89.44%. It means that the sales manager is 89.44% sure that we'll be attaining 480,000 units or beyond that. So it is advisable, since the confidence rate or the probability rate is much higher, the sales manager may well decide their production should go ahead. Right, students? So here we are checking the authenticity of the forecast. Now we are seeing that the authenticity is 90%. The certainty level is 90% or close to 90%. So it means the forecast or the assumptions are right. So the up to 90%. So the sales manager can move ahead with the production process. Now see another example. Example 2. A second product has associated fixed cost of 23 lakhs. The selling price will be £14.50. Variable cost £8.75. The sales manager predicts that the main sales for the coming year would be 6 lakhs. So students, you can now say that the mu will be what? 6 lakhs, and the line dividing that normal curve will be at 6 lakh units. She also believes that the sales volume is normally distributed and there is 60% chance. See students, we are now from in the previous question we have calculated probability. Now here it is probability. You are having probability and you have to calculate the Z value. There is a 60% chance that sales will be within 2 lakh units of the average, right? When I say 2 lakh, it means it can be 2 lakh above or 2 lakh below, right? What is the probability that profits will be at least £2,30,000, right? So first, the first step will be same. You have to calculate the break-even point, because that will be your X, right? Because we have to see whether how far your assumptions are correct. So first of all, you are assuming for break-even point. So break-even point is coming as, I'm using the same data. I think you are very much familiar with this formula now. So 23 lakhs divided by 14.5 minus 8.75, that will give you 4 lakh units. So now let us draw the normal curve. Now, see, as I told you, this will be your mean line, 6 lakh units. Average is given. BP will be again 4 lakh units. Now, you have to look at the question once again. It is written here, 60% chance that sales will be within 2 lakh units of the average, right? So this here you know that it can drop to by 2 lakh units to reach to break even point, but it can also move go to 8 lakhs crossing your mean line. So that is what is given here. The shaded area in the diagram below represents the chance that sales will be below average but within 2 lakh limits units of it. If there is a 60% chance that sales would be 2 lakh units above or below the average, then the shaded area has an associated probability of what? 0.6 divided by 2. 30% for below 6 lakhs and 30% for above 6 lakhs, right? So that is what I have written here. Now, again we'll move to table Z to find out the mean at P. We have to find out the mean when the probability is 0.03, right? So I'll be taking the next slide where we have calculated this thing. Now see, students, you are not getting the right figure as 0.03. so what the in the question it is given as minus 0.845. see, again why I'm taking the minus figure, because it is below this mean line 4 lakh, right? 6 lakh is your mean line, 4 lakh is below 2 lakh. So that is why minus figure is bound to be there. Now we have to calculate 0.3. Now we have to look at the Z figure, Z table. See, you are not accurately getting the 0.3. So here you can say 0.295 we are getting. So between these two figures, you have to interpolate 0.8 from here, 0.4, and between 0.4 and 0.4 and 0.05, you have to interpolate, right? So now this is what is written here, minus 0.845. Now I think you have understood this figure has come from interpolation. So using the formula for standard deviation, again Z is equal to X minus mu divided by standard deviation. So your Z is minus 8.45. just now you have calculated 4 lakhs will be your X, mu will be 6 lakh divided by standard deviation. So you can easily find out the standard deviation is 2,36,687 units. Now we have sufficient data to find out the probability profits would be at least £2,30,000. So now again we have to find out the desired profit. So we'll be using the same formula which I have told you in the previous lecture, desired profit divided by the, since all the fixed costs are already recovered at the break-even point, so the entire contribution will go to the profits only. So £2,30,000 divided by S minus V, it will give you 40,000 units. It means you have to produce 40,000 units more to attain the profit of £2,30,000. But now see, what is the probability, right? So probability, the break-even point we have found out is 4 lakhs. So now we have to sell how many units more? 40,000. So now X will be not 4 lakhs, it will be 4,40,000 units. So now again we'll calculate the Z. Minus 4,40,000 plus 6 lakhs divided by standard deviation we have just calculated 2,36,687. That will give you a figure of minus 0.68. Now again we'll refer to the Z table, right? So now this is your Z table. So we have 0.6 from here, 0.08 from here. You are getting the value as 0.2517. See students, this table, looking at this table is very easy. You have to see the score from here, and the integer part should be looked up from here, then the decimal part will be looked up from here. 0.2517, right? 0.6 and 0.08. So that will give you 0.68. The value will be 0.2517. Right, students? So here we go. So 0.64 will be giving you 0.2518 points. Now, as I told you earlier, that it should be at least at least profit should be 2,30,000. So we'll be taking up the 0.5 region more. Here we'll be taking up this region also. So that we have taken up in the previous question also, because the word at least is given, so we have to take into consideration this part also. So that will again be doing the same exercise. 0.2518 plus 0.5 is equal to 0.7518. That is 75%. So this manager is 75% confident that with this cost structure we'll be break even at 4 lakh units, and if we want to attain a profit of £2,30,000, we have to produce 40,000 units more. So this is again a very high percentage of probability. So students, so this is how we can analyze whether the forecast we are making are good or not. So this will test the quality of your forecast, right? So student, I hope you have understood this thing. So we'll moving ahead to the next topic, that is multi-product break-even analysis. This is the last part of this your entire topic of CVP or break-even analysis. Now, as I have been telling you over and over that there are very rare situations where the company is continuing with one single product. So this is the time of conglomerates, diversified companies, multi-product companies like HUL. So we have to calculate multi-product break-even analysis. Now, I'm giving you the same figure. The company has three product lines, X, Y, and Z, and these are your data, sales and cost data. Selling price for X is 9, for Y is 7, for Z it is 5, and the fixed costs are £2,000 per period and are not attributable to individual products, right? This is the sales revenue, this is the variable cost, contribution, this is the entire data given here. But this process is very simple. Now, how we will calculate the multi-product break-even point? So, for calculation of multi-product break-even point, you have to take into consideration total fixed cost, not only selling price minus variable cost. Here, we have to take weighted average selling price minus weighted average variable expenses. See, this weight is basically the proportion in which your entire product basket is divided. In case in the given question, we have assumed that 400 units will be sold of X, 5 for Y, 400 units, and for Z it is 200 units. So the proportion will be 40%, 40%, and 20%. This is the weights. These are the weights. So sales revenue will be 9 into 40% plus 7 into 40%. See, these are the unit selling price given here in the question. 5 into 20%, that will give you weighted average selling price as £7.4. In the same way, I have calculated the variable cost, 6 into 40%, 5 into 40%, 1 into 20%. Again, the variable cost is given here, right? So, we'll be getting $4.6. Now, 7.5 minus 4.6 will be your weighted average contribution. Now, break-even point would be, since fixed costs are not attributable, so we'll be taking up together altogether. So, break-even point will be 714 units. Now, in total, the company has to produce 714 units. Now, again, we have to divide it into X, Y, and Z in the same proportion, 40% X, 40% Y, and Z 20%. Now, this is what I have done. So 714 of 40% will be 285 units. 714 of 40% is 280. There's a little bit of you can say round off is there. You are getting a result as 285.5. So I am taking only 285, and here we'll be having Z is equal to 714 multiplied by 20%, so 144 units. So students, this total 714 units will be divided among X and Y and Z in this way. So if you are producing with this composition, you will be break even at 714 units. So students, this is how you can calculate multi-product break-even point, right? So students, this is all for this topic. We'll come again with the fresh topics in the name of linear programming, where we'll be dealing how to deal with multiple limiting factors. The single limiting factor problem can be dealt by CVP analysis, but when you confront the situation, when you have multiple limiting factors or multiple scarce resources, you have to resort to the statistical phenomena like linear programming. So students, thank you.